Hello and welcome back to Townhill Junction. Today we're going to be reviewing our potential plans for a fairly large station, having a look through some of the models we've already got and having a discussion about what's the best setup. Should we be going for two tiers, place for storage, fiddle yard? Should we be going for something more simple that we know we can actually achieve? Love your thoughts, comments via Facebook, Instagram, or in the comments here on YouTube. Now let's go and have a look at what we've got here at Townhill Junction. Here at Townhill Junction, the idea is to have a Scottish-based station loosely based on what could have happened if Dunfermline had remained the capital and the junction at Townhill had become a main interchange terminus between main lines and kind of more commuter-based branch lines. As you can see here, we've got a rough layout of a fairly large station. Lots of people do half a station or a third of a station using the curves at the far end, just to give them more scenery space. I've always liked stations. I've always found them the most interesting part of the station. So I thought, what could I do here? What could I do that would be maybe a little bit different? The idea is to have two terminus lines for kind of DMUs, short commuter services. So not much longer than kind of three coaches, as you can see here by the 170s. The kind of upturned line looking there is outside the platform. Gives me a bit of room to put a kind of road or something in there. And we can play about with this. It's a bit of a rough kind of layout just now, just to have a look at what it would look like. See if we're being too silly. Then we'd have kind of the two main branch lines. These lines would come, go straight through the station. It would allow us to stable kind of larger 5-car, 6-car trains with potential room for a small DMU at the far end. And they'd continue around what would be the branch line at Townhill Junction. The outer two lines, seen here by the 156 and the ScotRail HST, would be the main lines. These would come round and be used for kind of longer trains. Just give me a bit of running speed. It would tie in nicely to the kind of running lines that I'm envisaging for the far side. As you can see, I do have one outer line as well. The idea of this is to give myself one large siding, which allows me to do a bit more interest, swapping trains round. And in effect, that middle line, currently occupied by the Class 156, would become the real siding, with the outer two lines on either side of a kind of island platform running the full length of the station. I'd love to know your thoughts, love to know your comments, love to know what you think. Is it too large? Should we go smaller? Should we go bigger? How do you find running trains through stations? How do you find movements? What works for you? What have you tried and what's failed? Let's all share some experience and help me get a bit of guidance before I put these baseboards down for film. We're now going to have a look at some of the models we've already got here at Townhill Junction. Over the past few episodes, you've been able to see some of the stuff boxed, not quite running, and whilst they're not boxed today, they do have their own boxes, they won't quite be running yet. But we have had some test runs on the DCC Concepts Rolling Road, which has given us some good test runs through the sound and light features that comes with DCC. So let's have a look at each of the models in turn, give you our thoughts, and have a look at, by ending up with the LNER large train at the end, we'll get an idea of the scale of what we're potentially looking at here, and it was a fairly small loft layout. We start off with this Backman Class 158. One of the newest models in their scene. It's not in this livery. Thanks to the guys at Rainbow Railways who've resprayed this absolutely perfectly, we now have a ScotRail version, 158789. You can see there it's got passenger door indicator lights, running lights, sound, internal coach lights. It runs really, really well. If you look back to last episode, you'll see it going around my uncle's layout, Glen Ogle. And if you go to the episode before, you'll see a full review of this fantastically detailed model with perfectly resprayed. I've always liked 158s. I think they're one of the comfiest trains that we've got in the fleet in ScotRail just now. The slightly older, comfier seats. Absolute dream to sit and commute back and forward on. We then have one of three Class 170s. In the ScotRail livery, these things are fantastic. They go online fairly often. Two of them have already been chipped for me. It's DCC, and I've got one that's DC that needs to be chipped. The only problem with this model is that it does have a motor right in the middle power car, which makes it not ideal for lighting up. But this is something that's kind of small modifications that others have definitely done, and something we might consider doing here at Townhill Junctions in the future. We have three. They're the staple of the Fife Circle at the moment, taking commuters in 3s, 5s and 6s. Always as a 170s and a 3, but with different combinations with the 158s, other 170s, taking commuters back and forward across the Central Belt. Predominantly moved away from the newly electrified lines of the Central Belt. You can see them running around Fife continuously. The hope is to run my second 158, as you can see here, also resprayed by Rainbow Railways, number 713, in a 5-car formation. I just find them really interesting. The mismatch between the 170 and the 158 just makes a really interesting running shot. With a bit more time, hopefully we can have different combinations, just creating a bit more interest here at Townhill Junction. But again, it's kind of maxing out this half of the station. Thoughts are to maybe see if I can just about squeeze 6 coaches in, and we'll go and have a look down the other end for some more interest once we've finished going through these 156s next. You can see here with the older 156s, the predecessors to the 158s, a bit more boxy and line up with the 153s, which we'll speak about later in the video. This one's one of the real track ones, comes with really good detailed lights fitted, internal coach lighting, sound. It's an absolute dream. We've got two of these at Townhill Junction. You can see here styling and platform. We do have our third, however. The third is one of the Hornby versions. Now, those who have followed us on Facebook for a while will know that we had one of the Hornby versions in the Salt Air Blue, but the light blue just really didn't match. It was so different. So this one we sent off to a good friend, Kevin, who's made this fantastic model with modifications along the side to make it akin to the real track version, even fitted passengers. Gives us our first passenger service here at Townhill Junction. You can see some of the similarities here between the two models. One done by hand shows what you can do if you put your mind to it. The match is fairly good. The base model of the Hornby version is not bad, but the detail underneath that you see here just isn't fitted. This is something that's had to take time and money to reproduce. And that's why we have our third 156 here at Townhill Junction, based on that Hornby model. In the outer lanes, we've got these two sets of HSTs. Both come with 4 cars each, with individual running numbers. These express services have been a real boost to the ScotRail system here in Scotland, taking express services up and down the country, giving a bit of luxury we've just not really experienced here for a long, long time. The livery in real life and in these models is beautiful. Whilst I don't have the coaches out today, they do look stunning. And if you look back at an earlier video, we did run one back when we had the test layout down the living room at the start of lockdown. We have DCC chips ready to be fitted. That's one of the jobs over the next couple of months. And let's hope we'll see two of them running opposite each other side by side very, very soon. These are great models still. Whilst Hornby are making some changes to make them a bit more competitive, in this livery, they'd still look stunning. The couplers, these ones here replaced by Westhill Wagon Works original kind of magnetic coupling does bring them a bit closer together. But I think they'll look great. I do wish Hornby would do the Coach E, with sets across Scotland, all four car sets to start with, now becoming five. That fifth Coach E, a bit of a mistake I think in the original Hornby order, still hasn't come onto market yet. And with no intentions, despite emails, I really would like that. They look stunning as five car sets, rather than the simple four. Talking of HSTs, let's take a brief look whilst we're at this end of the station of this LNER. This LNER HST set is one of the longest sets that we've got at Townhill Junction. It's really kind of giving us the scale that we're looking for. I don't want to run just tiny DMUs all the time. End-to-end layouts are interesting, but only to me for a short while. I want to run big, prototypical length trains. And with this as a guide, we might even start looking at the Acura scale Caledonian Sleepers coming out later this year. You can see this is actually quite a striking model as well. The red and white, now replaced by the Azuma Class 800s, ran up and down as far north as Aberdeen and Inverness, all the way to London. For me, having a layout here, I need to have a mix. I want to have local commuter services and these long express trains with boofy cars, proper running numbers. The only problem is I do need to look at putting coach lighting in. And when you've got this many, it's a fair job in itself. You can see the sort of scale. The boards kind of run out at the end there, but there is space for another kind of board up to the plasterboard. We can just fit it in. By being on the outside of the curve, we just get that little bit more space. With third radius curves as a guide up there, you can see there's plenty of room to get them turned, although that looks like it will have to be off shot. It's why so many modellers hide that part of their models under tunnels, with half the station sticking out, to make it look like they go on straight forever and ever. But there's something about seeing a station, big long express train sitting in a station waiting, that just really interests me. Waiting for that guard's whistle, waiting for them to move off and head down. Talking of heading down, let's head down to the other end of the station and have a look. One of the options is to obviously remove this section, make it smaller, get rid of it entirely. Or do we keep it? Do we go for DMUs stabling at both sides? And you might have spied one of our two Class 153s. These new Class 153s are stunning. The special livery to denote the active travel was specially designed. We might do a full video on these once we get them running. This one here, seen in pristine condition. Again, a Rainbow Railways respray. It just looks stunning. The addition of the DMU passing the Glenfinnan viaduct and the monument. The area here you can see blacked out signifies where the bikes go in the summer, but also skis and snowboards in the winter. It's hoped that these will encourage people to take up the train, get into one end of the route, moving their way back. It's a huge bonus. Current TMUs, like these 156s that you're usually coupled with, only really have room for about two or three bikes and cause absolute havoc when touring parties want to use them. Such a great idea, and we're going to see these 153s, which are kind of old redundant trains, being coupled up, and we're going to see them across Scotland, going as far north as Thurso to help those cycling all the way from John O'Groats all the way to Land's End, and from Oban, Fort William, all across the Western Highlands, just to give that different space. I think it's about 22, 25 bikes they can fit in there, and even more skis and snowboards. You can get a proper ticket for that. As you can see, we've got two. This other one, not so pristine, slightly weathered, but more realistic. Something I've kind of chosen against so far in my models to get them weathered. I think there's something nice about them being pristine, but they do just look more realistic. The ScotRail logo still striking. Couple additions that I need to add to these in terms of transfer packs that have come in from these concept models that were out before the real ones are in service to the ones that are in service now. Running as three car sets, I think they look stunning. They make the 156s make sense, and stable against one of those 170s, you get a real idea of the lovely colour, brightness that we're hopefully going to see here at Townhill Junction. Next up, Class 68s. These locals, provided by DRS, Direct Rail Services, are daring and valiant. They ran the local hauled five circle trains, with five or six carriages, which we do have at Townhill Junction, still in the box, getting towed round at peak times, giving huge amounts of additional capacity on what's a very, very busy commuter route. The Class 68s are stunning, brand new locomotives, and you can see them now in their DRS livery, supporting intermodal freight all across Scotland and the UK. But these two were absolute favourites of mine. You'd see them flying past, and just gave an absolute new dimension. And for those who prefer local haul trains to DMUs, you might have noticed I'm not one of them, but these are stunning, and I can't disagree. With Backman's new coaches fully lit up, with passenger door lights, these are going to be a great addition to Townhill Junction, and will help with our long six coach trains on these busy, busy long lines, will help Townhill Junction look so, so busy at those peak times. With express trains getting in the way of the normal morning commute, these smaller trains never quite having enough room for all the passengers, I think it's a real mix and gives us a real bit of interest here. Now, if we're talking prototypically, one of these would run one way, they would go round the five circle and return back the same way. Now, with a runaround layout, that's not possible. Should we have some way of decoupling them, moving the locals from one end to the other, and then bringing the trains back to kind of replicate that real-life service that Edinburgh Waverley was so common to see? Or do we just leave them, one in each direction, whizzing round? I don't know. As you can see here, you can see that end board, that mess. There is still room. Just. So what do we want in here? Do you want a building towering over the top of the station? Do we want to cut it off? Do we want half a station? Do we want to take this off? Is this too ambitious? It does give us lots of room on this side. Enough to negate the need of a underground fiddle yard? Or do we keep going as is? We want to look at inclines, but I want the idea of trains running around this side of the layout. See here by this kind of test board on this side. And then whizzing back underneath and then coming back round in kind of a figure of eight. You only see the trains on their second pass. There's plenty of work still to do here at Townhill Junction, but hopefully soon we'll have some great running shots and you'll be able to see this taking shape. With lots of wood in the garage now cleared, there's plenty of space to now cut it up, get it to size, and start making these test boards a real reality. Thank you so much for watching this journey with me. We'd love your comments. And for now, let's sneak over to the main line for one of those rides of a lifetime. A 30th birthday present that I never even imagined I could get. Thanks for watching here at Townhill Junction.
Through this wee bit, so that'll let them get away a wee bit more. It was funny when I had the BBC folk out, and because obviously it was the BBC, we were a bit more on the ball and stuff, and had a chaperone.